Greetings. Well, this video is a bit of a celebration for me. This will be my 350th upload. And I have actually tried to repeat myself. On this special occasion, I want to address a claim, indeed a blasphemous claim, by Islam. Thank you, Muslim Brother Truth Vanquishes, for volunteering this error taught by Islam. Isaiah 42 talks about a prophet who is coming to the descendants of Ishmael, Kedar, who live on the Isles, Arabic Peninsula, who will be a warrior, and he will come with a covenant for the Gentiles. This is another, howbeit less frequently mentioned, claim of the foretelling of Muhammad. Let's read through Isaiah 42, 1 through 13, and with each verse I'd like to cover three things. 1. What is the real meaning? 2. What does Islam claim? 3. What is the error and reason for Islam's claim? I may or may not address a given point on a given verse. Isaiah 42, verse 1. Behold my servant, whom I uphold, mine elect, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He shall bring forth judgment to the Gentiles. Behold my servant. Clearly this speaks of a servant or prophet of God, maybe even the prophet of Deuteronomy 18:15, whom I uphold. This phrase seems nebulous until you examine what uphold means. Uphold, to give support to. This is an active action. God supported Jesus with signs and wonders and miracles. God never once supported Muhammad. Not one miracle. I have put my spirit upon him. The real meaning is Jesus, on whom the Lord poured out the Holy Spirit. John 3:34, for he is sent by God. He speaks God's words, for God gives him the Spirit without limit. That is literal and clear and consistent with the triune nature of God. Islam is inconsistent and has no definition for Spirit or Holy Spirit, especially when defining what "put my Spirit upon him" actually means. He shall bring forth judgment to the Gentiles. I could make a whole video on this phrase. Basically, there is no judgment if there is no law. Jesus brought the law to the Gentiles, even though he was not a prophet to them. Jesus established the covenant by which Gentiles, all mankind, could receive Abraham's promise. Islam does not leverage this verse, but will make up an excuse if forced. They would claim Muhammad brought judgment to non-Muslim pagans. There is an interesting ignorance of terms used by Islam. They say pagans a lot. The word Gentile has no real usage in Islam, because they would be the Gentiles. The problem is that Muhammad never went to anyone but pagan Arabs. He shall not cry, nor lift up, nor cause his voice to be heard in the street. A bruised reed shall he not break, and the smoking flax shall he not quench. He shall bring forth judgment unto truth. The disciples learned this spoke of Messiah, Jesus. Matthew 12:18, behold my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved, in whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he will show judgment to the Gentiles. He will not quarrel, nor cry out, nor will anyone hear his voice in the streets. And this is one of those facts troubling for Islam to make a rational excuse regarding. This prophecy was known and fulfilled already. So, 3. The error is that Mohammedism is desperately trying to rewrite established history. Now, to meta-think about this, you must realize two patterns. Here's the first. The Old Testament prophets revealed God's message. Jesus came and fulfilled them, fulfilled the message. The disciples recorded the fulfillment. It is a sealed, consistent, finished story. No dangling, unanswered questions. Here is the second pattern. The Old Testament prophets revealed God's message. The message is fulfilled and sealed. Muhammad claims he is foretold, with no specifics. Followers of Muhammad cannot find his name, so they look for key words. Prophet, servant, unlearned, camel, warrior, Kedar. Create a story linking the word to Muhammad. Create attacks against the original fulfillment. The pattern, or jihad, is the exact same all across virtually every argument for Muhammad in the Torah or Bible. He shall not cry, nor lift up, nor cause his voice to be heard in the street. How does this mean, Muhammad? Push a Mohammedan, and they will invent something, on the spot if necessary. Isaiah 42:4, he shall not fail, nor be discouraged, till he has set judgment in the earth, and the isles shall wait for his law. Only an eternal being can accomplish this in the whole earth. Islam will claim isles are waiting for the Quran. The problem is they wait for his law, not Allah's law. Islam must counter, claiming this is meaningless and means Allah's law. Thus saith God the Lord, he that created the heavens and stretched them out, he that spread forth the earth and that which comes out of it, he that gives breath unto the people upon it, and spirit to them that walk therein. God the Lord. This establishes who is talking. God, Yahweh, who made heaven and earth. I, the Lord, have called thee in righteousness, and will hold thine hand, and will keep thee, and give thee for a covenant of the people, for a light unto the Gentiles. So this is God the Lord speaking to his servant. Notice what God says, because it can be misread. And will keep thee, and give thee for a covenant of the people, and give thee for a covenant. The true reading of that statement gives me goosebumps. Jesus was given, a child given, to establish the new covenant. Isaiah 9:6, for unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and give thee for a covenant. Islam must change the text to insert a useful meaning. They must change it to send Muhammad with a book. Push them that a book is not a covenant, and they will quickly change terminology. But Islam is not a covenant, even if you change covenant to promise. There are no terms and no limits on this entity Allah who damns who he wills. To open the blind eyes, to bring out the prisoners from the prison, and them that sit in darkness out of the prison house. Islam will never mention this, because it does not dare. Muhammad never opened blind eyes, and they acknowledge Jesus did. And when they do, they must say, by Allah's permission, and give thee for a covenant of the people, for a light of the Gentiles, to open the blind eyes, to bring out the prisoners from the prison, and them that sit in darkness out of the prison house. So where did Jesus release prisoners from a Roman prison? It was not from a Roman prison. Ephesians 4:8, wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive, and gave gifts unto men. Isaiah 42:8, I am Yahweh, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. Now, brother, when you claimed Isaiah 42 foretold Muhammad, I raised this with you. I am Yahweh, that is my name. And you simply refused to read what prophet Isaiah revealed. But for you brothers and sisters in Christ, know this. Know that you know that you know. I am Yahweh, that is my name. End of discussion, debate, doubt, and Satan's deception. I am Yahweh, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. Remember, this is all in the context that Islam claims Isaiah 42 foretells Muhammad. Muhammad and Islam, who do not know the name of God, is Yahweh. Behold, the former things are come to pass, and new things do I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. Sing unto Yahweh a new song, and his praise from the end of the earth, you that go down to the sea, and all that is therein, the isles, and the inhabitants thereof. Let the wilderness and the cities thereof lift up their voice, the villages that Kedar doth inhabit. Let the inhabitants of the rock sing, let them shout from the top of the mountains. Remember, Islam will pick even only one word to claim fits Muhammad. In this verse, the word is Kedar. But inconsistent as always, Islam will ignore other mention of Kedar. Jeremiah 49:28, about Kedar, and the kingdoms of Hazor, which Nebuchadnezzar, Babylon's king, defeated. This is what the Lord Yahweh says. Now, don't you think it'd be important if you're claiming that Kedar means Muhammad and Islam? This is what the Lord Yahweh says. Rise up, go against Kedar, and destroy the people of the east. So even when Islam tries to cherry-pick a word, they choose poorly. Rise up, go against Kedar, and destroy the people of the east. Let them give glory unto the Lord Yahweh and declare his praise in the islands. Remember, the Islamic claim is that Isaiah 42:1-13 foretells Muhammad. Here, however, is the real blasphemy in this false claim. Remember the key words Islam searches for: prophet, servant, unlearned, camel, Kedar, warrior. Well, in the next verse, 42:13, it finds the word warrior. Islam finds this phrase, shall go forth as a warrior, and Muhammad being a warrior. This is all they imagine. The problem is the rest of the verse in the blue. Who is this warrior? The Lord, Yahweh. The Lord, God, Yahweh is the warrior. And this verse about Almighty God, Islam claims, is for Muhammad, their actual Allah. Oh, Muslim, please think, brother. Islam is so desperate to prove it is legitimate. Islam is so afraid that Muhammad is a liar. Islam will twist the message of the prophets about God to mean Muhammad. If you sincerely honor God, this should strike you in your soul. You cannot honor God and give Muhammad the glory due to God alone. If Islam will do this, it is not from God, brother. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who Isaiah 42 really talks about. Amen.